Welcome to VLAN mini-series, where we're going to start from the very basics and progress towards more advanced setups for experienced network engineers. If you're new to the term VLAN and you're wondering what even is that, then in this video you will get all your answers and more. VLANs are great if you're looking for an efficient and secure way to set up your networks. They are especially handy if you need to isolate different people or different devices and you want your setup to be easily adjustable. VLANs allow for more affordable setups as you might be able to replace some of your routers with switches. But even if you are not a network engineer for a big company, they might come in handy in your home network. Some use it for their wireless to separate guest devices or IoT devices from their home network. Personally, my favorite use case is to take a single Ethernet port that I have on a computer like this laptop and split it into multiple. VLAN or VLAN stands for virtual LAN, and VLANs basically allow us to divide LAN into multiple isolated segments. To best explain them, I will need to talk a little bit about local area networks. Typically, when you think of LAN, you are probably thinking of some broad definition like private network that is confined to a physical location, a building, or some small area. An image of an office comes to mind where IP addressing is established and you either have all your devices on a single IP network or you might split them up in groups using subnets or multiple local network address ranges. But the term LAN actually refers to more than the physical proximity of devices or the IP configuration. In these videos, we will define LAN as a single broadcast domain. What that means is that any two devices that are physically connected and have established a data link are on the same LAN. Because they can now exchange network frames using MAC addressing, and if one were to send a frame destined to the broadcast MAC address, the other one would receive it as they are in the same broadcast domain. And furthermore, if the device receiving the broadcast frame is a simple switch or a router with bridged ports, it will further send this broadcast frame to a number of connected devices. So if a third device can receive this frame, it is also in the same broadcast domain and in the same LAN. Now let's say we want to add another device, but we want to isolate it from the third one. Well, we could simply not put them in the same bridge, and as a result, they will be in separate broadcast domains and essentially separate LANs. But the L009 here would also be isolated from the first device. So we could have four devices in the same local area, all connected, but there would be two LANs that are separated on layer 2, the data link layer. They could still be configured to have IPs and communicate through routing the network layer packets, but the CPU on the CRS in the middle might have to do some work because it would now have to act as a gateway, where it has to consider the routing table and the firewall rules. We could improve this setup with VLANs, and there are actually several ways to do that, both in terms of the VLAN topology and in how we configure our MikroTik devices. The best configuration will depend on what you need to accomplish and on what switch chip is housed in your device. So what do I want to accomplish? I want my laptop to have layer 2 connectivity with the HAP AC squared, but not have all of them in the same broadcast domain so that I can do things like run net install and have Winbox access without a configured IP. I want my laptop to exchange layer 2 frames like ARP and MNDP with the HAP AC, but keep it isolated from the L009. So what can I do here? There is only one physical connection from the laptop. I need to split it virtually in two using VLANs. We are starting with no existing configuration, and I will show you the most basic VLAN configuration possible, even though it will not be the most efficient one for this particular CRS, as it will not take advantage of hardware offloading, but it is the most simple option, and it will work on literally any routerless device. The configuration on SwitchOS is obviously different, and I will not get into that for now, as we already have a good video on configuring VLANs in SwitchOS by Edgars, who is an expert on the VLAN topic, and I'm actually consulting with him myself. Alright, on the CRS, go to the interface VLAN section. There we can add new interface with the name of our liking. I prefer to just name them VLAN followed by the VLAN ID I will use. The range you should use for these IDs is from 2 to 4094. ID 1 is usable as well, but it has special purpose in some equipment. And then the interface in this case is the one connected to the laptop. That's how easy it is to create a couple of VLAN interfaces. Now any frames that we send to these will have VLAN tags inserted into their frame structure, and the altered frames will exit the Ether24 interface. Similarly, VLAN tag traffic coming into the Ether24 interface will have their tags removed, and the frames will be sent out the appropriate VLAN interfaces untagged. But at this point, they don't lead to anything just yet. To help you further understand this topic, I will give you a quick brief on VLAN tags. A typical layer 2 frame has a very specific structure that was designed at the very beginning of the Ethernet protocol. Every single piece of network equipment is expecting that when it receives a frame and it reads it bit by bit, that the very 6 octets, also known as bytes, are going to be the MAC destination address. The next 6 octets will be the MAC source address, and after that there will be 2 octets containing ether type, which indicates what kind of payload is encapsulated. Now, VLAN tags were a later invention, and when they were used, they changed this structure by essentially inserting a 4-octet VLAN header before this regular ether type. Since this is altering the very fabric of Ethernet, we have to respect that VLAN tags can lead to all sorts of unexpected behaviors. First of all, if you incorrectly add or don't add this tag, when VLANs are not configured on a piece of networking equipment and it receives a frame with the VLAN tag, it will simply drop it. So that means that not only will it break the network or IP layer, but it will also break other layer 2 protocols such as ARP and network discovery. Similarly, adding a VLAN tag where there shouldn't be any can also cause problems. For example, the spanning tree protocol and its derivatives like RSTP. Those protocols rely on sending out special frames out of all bridged or switched ports so that the other devices that receive them can detect potential traffic loops before they occur and manage their own physical ports to prevent that. It is generally a good idea to use them, as accidents happen. You plug in the wrong cable in the wrong port, and all of a sudden, your whole network becomes unresponsive due to a traffic loop. Spanning tree prevents that. The problem here is that adding VLAN tags to these special frames can completely break those protocols. So we have to be mindful about how we handle them. On that note, let's bridge one of our newly created VLAN interfaces to a physical Ethernet port. When we create a bridge, by default it is set to protocol mode RSTP. In this case, the protocol will be pretty broken because the tagged RSTP frames will be ignored when received at a physical port, and further, they might get untagged and spewed out other bridged ports. In the next video, we will learn how to handle networks using VLAN-aware bridging, or as we call it, VLAN filtering. It will allow us to use VLANs in conjunction with the spanning tree protocols, but at this time we simply have to disable RSTP on our bridge. Next, we can add the ports as usual, and now we will be able to use this VLAN for layer 2 protocols. But this is a very crude way of doing things. In addition to losing the spanning tree, we also cannot benefit from the hardware offloading in this matter, so it is generally not advised to do it this way. VLAN filtering will be a much more efficient method for the CRS-326. The VLAN interface method we are using now is more suitable for routing. The interfaces we create are a lot like physical interfaces. Instead of just bridging, we can assign IP addresses, set up DHCP servers and firewalls, and basically do all the other layer 3 stuff we need. So, we'll use routing for VLAN 20, but first let's finish up with VLAN 10. All that is left to do to make it functional is to handle the VLAN tag 10 on the laptop. Funny enough, this can easily be done from the GUI, both in Linux and in Mac, but in Windows you will likely have to resort to PowerShell. Anyhow, in Network Manager GUI, it will look something like this. Open up the Network Manager settings and click the Add button. Select VLAN. Then select the parent interface and enter the VLAN ID and name. Finally, if there is no DHCP server running on the VLAN that you are connecting to, make sure to add some local address. Otherwise, Linux will not route layer 2 frames correctly, even if you are not using IP addressing. If I now check Winbox neighbors, you can see that there is another device besides the CRS that I can connect to using MAC address, because layer 2 traffic can successfully run through the VLAN. The app I see at the other end can operate as usual without any knowledge of the existence of VLAN in this network. It will know that it is connected to the CRS and it will see whatever is at the other end of this VLAN. We could even net install it from the laptop if we wanted. Now let's do a routed setup for VLAN 20 so that you can see the difference. To make that happen, I will just set up static routing with the CRS as a gateway. I need to assign an IP address to VLAN 20 from the network and an address from another network to Ether 8. Then connect to the L009 and assign an IP from the same network as Ether 8. Also set the CRS as the default gateway. After that, add a new VLAN on the computer just like we did it before, but this time in the IPv4 section, we need to use an IP from the correct network and we also have to set a route to the L009. This time, when I open Winbox, there again is another entry, but it is to the CRS. We cannot receive network discovery packets from the L009 in this manner. If we manually enter its IP, we can now connect through VLAN 20. In conclusion, here is what we have done. We took what would be a single broadcast domain and a single port for the laptop and virtually divided it. We did not create a trunk port, however. It is more like a hybrid port. We can use the two virtual broadcast domains along with the regular network connection, which is still functional and as long as the VLANs are not being used at the same time, can still be operated with the same throughput. I hope you make use of this and stay tuned for the next video on VLANs where we will do more advanced configurations with proper trunk and access ports. Right now, all these devices connected to the CRS can see it, but in the next one, the CRS will become invisible. If you enjoyed this, make sure to like, subscribe, and leave a comment or two so that the algorithm knows this was good stuff, and I will see you in the next one.